Okay, folks, live from Fernwood, it's the mayoral candidates today at Fernwood Community Association. So thanks, everybody, for coming out, and I want to, on behalf of the Fernwood Community Association, of which I have the honor of serving as president, my name is Tony Sprackett, and I want to take this opportunity to say thank you to all these candidates who are stepping up and running for office. It's a huge deal, and I think that sometimes people forget that they're doing it out of civic interest. So I think that they all deserve a round of applause. And with that, I'm going to turn this over to the Fernwood Community Association's Land Use Chair, David Maxwell. David is very well respected in the Fernwood Community Association, and we trust him to handle this ably. Thank you.
Thanks, Tony. No pressure there. I'm holding this in my hand because I just remembered I need to turn it off. So I would encourage you to turn yours off as well, please, or put it on mute or whatever you do. Thank you. Okay, we're going to be done by 9 o'clock. Just put my watch here. And Joanne is acting as our timekeeper for the various things. And so the format is going to be 2-minute introductions from all the candidates and 2-minute closing comments, and then 1-minute response to each of the questions. A little wrinkle that I picked up when I attended the James Bay forum was they allow one 30-second rebuttal for the ninth. So each of these candidates gets one chance to rebut something that only once. So we'll see how wisely they use it. And when Joanne's going to give, when she waves at them, means they have 15 seconds left. And when the minute's up, the microphone's going to be turned off. This is my, and how they're going to communicate that from the front to the back, I don't know yet, but until it works. If not, Joanne will then, maybe you should indicate when the time's up as well. If you stood up then, he could know to turn off the microphone, right? Okay, thanks. Good idea. Thanks. Before we start, though, I would like to, we were thinking about taking written questions from the floor, but realistically, in the amount of time we have, I don't think you should burden yourself by writing a written question. I've got questions here. I've got questions that were left over from the other forums I attended, and so we've got more than enough questions. But before we start, I'd like to give a shout out to the Pandora Arts Collective, which meets here in this hall and has for over 10 years. They meet Tuesdays and Thursdays from noon to 4 p.m. And the purpose of this nonprofit therapeutic arts program is to create a welcoming, self-directed studies environment, providing supplies and assistance at little or no cost. And if you're interested in knowing more about this, go to pandoraarts.ca. That's the ad for the night. Okay, well, I think we'll start with the 2-minute introductions. And Tony and I drew names out of a hat, and Dean Fortin is going first.
Thank you very much, and I do want to start by acknowledging that we are gathered here today on the traditional territories of the Squamish and Songhees First Nations. Thank you, and I truly appreciate both all the volunteers and the organizations that are hosting this meeting, an opportunity for us to engage with you in this most amazing process of democracy. For those that don't know me, I am a Fernwood resident. I just live up on, well, I should call it the Fernwood's Oaklands, because that section between Bay Street and Haltane is highly disputed between but I live over there. I have two kids. One's go to Oakland School, the other one goes to Lansdowne. This is my community, my neighborhood, and I do want to highlight and say especially the thanks for all the people who have continued to build this village. It is what makes Victoria strong, all the different villages, all the people that make it up in their own interesting, unique way, and I look forward to talking more about that. For the last 6 years, we've been working really hard on building a progressive city. A city that is green, but also making sure that we have a city that is moving forward, that is a livable city, and one that is a prosperous city. We've worked really hard and invested in those issues that are important to you. Affordable housing, green transportation, and of course, protecting our built and most especially natural environment. Over the next 4 years, I really want to focus more on more affordable housing. We have a commitment for 250 units of supportive housing, another 1,500 units of affordable housing. That's key. We want to move forward on more buses, more bike lanes. We've committed up to $5 million over the next 4 years to make that transformable shift. So instead of thinking about how we move cars, we think about how we move people in our communities, in our neighborhoods. And most especially, we want to continue to build our economy. We recognize that it's been a tough 6 years, but over those last 6 years, we've brought the tax increases down every year and enjoyed, for this year, the lowest tax increase in 14 years, but still managing to invest in what's important to you. Community centers, senior centers, and libraries. I look forward to engaging. Thank you very much.
I'm looking here, I can see there, so you go to the next one. Okay, well, we're still working on the timing technology. I think we'll get it down.
Thank you.
And next, we're going to hear from Changes the Clown.
One in five children, and an astounding one in two children of single mothers, live in poverty in Victoria.
Shame.
The province of BC has had the highest rate of child poverty in the country for 9 of the last 10 years, and the provincial government continues to stubbornly ignore this social crisis in our midst. Changes the Clown has become increasingly distressed at the failure of governments to address this social crisis in our community. One in five children and an astounding, one in two, that's right, half of all children of single mothers in Victoria live in poverty. And Changes wants people to join him in calling for something to be done about that. Changes the Clown believes that as the capital city of the province with the highest rate of child poverty in the country, year after year, the city of Victoria should demonstrate how this unacknowledged social crisis can be addressed at the municipal level, despite the fact that it actually falls under provincial but not municipal jurisdiction. The two main planks on the Changes for Mayor election platform address this crisis of child poverty. One of these is an affordable child care program, similar to the one that's currently being planned in the city of Vancouver. So there's a precedent for that at the municipal level in this province. The second main platform plank is a living wage policy, similar again to the one that has been in place in the city of New Westminster since 2010. For 4 years, they've had a policy like this in New Westminster. So in that game, there's a precedent for this within this province at the municipal level. These are not things that can't be done. As election day gets closer, I feel like I should point out to people that the purpose of the Changes for Mayor campaign is not to get votes. If you're a voter on the left, then you should be voting for the contender on the left and not for the clown. unless you want to register a protest vote, because that's all it would be. If you want to help out the Changes for Mayor campaign, talk to the politicians about your expectations about seeing something done about this.
Next is Jason Ross.
Hi, I'm Jason Ross, and I come at this from a very different approach. I'm not a politician, I'm not even a public speaker, I'm a programmer by trade. And so what I do is I look at a problem and I try and break it down and figure out what the flaws are and how you fix it. And one of the things that I've discovered on this journey for this election is the electoral process itself is severely flawed. We were testing for the wrong things. This type of meeting where we don't have the questions presented before us, we don't really have information to work off of, and we're told to respond in a short period of 1 minute. We get 2 minutes for introduction, which is twice as much time as we get to talk about a specific issue. And that's not what the mayor or council does. Mayor and council, they get reports, they get information, they look over it, and they get a few days to actually consider and reflect and research. And then they come to council and then they discuss it. And there isn't discussion happening at these things. There's not careful thought. I'm not an expert in most of the subject matter we're going to be talking about, unless we talk about IT, because like I said, I'm a programmer. And video, which I've got a camera and I've been video recording these meetings because I think it's important that it shouldn't just be for the people who attend, it should be for everybody. If you want to go on, I want to see it. But you should be able to have that option. So I'd like to take that approach to the way the city runs. I'd like to break down all the processes that we do. I'd like to break down the meetings of council themselves because they're really stuffy and they're hard to follow, and council doesn't do a good job of inviting you in and providing you the information in an easily digestible form. I mean, if you want to pay attention to even one issue, you have to read dozens and dozens of pages and do lots of hard work and research to even feel like you're part of the conversation. I think that could change.
Right on.
Okay, Lisa helps.
Thank you very much. First of all, welcome to all of you. Oh, maybe I should leave on the stand and then we won't get that feedback. I wanted to begin by saying that I'm really excited to be part of this debate tonight because this is the first ever debate in municipal politics in Victoria to be live streamed. So you're all sitting here, which is wonderful, but there are also people in Victoria that might be sitting at home in their pajamas with a cup of coffee or cup of tea watching this debate. And that's brought to us by a small organization called Stream of Consciousness in Victoria. And Stream of Consciousness for me is one example of all of the innovation and creativity that is brimming up in this city. We're bubbling over with creativity, with innovation, with good ideas. On council for the last 3 years, I've watched all too often these good ideas get turned away or take too long to come to fruition. So my commitment, I'll answer questions on topics later on in terms of what my priorities are. My commitment to you as your mayor is that you will be involved on an ongoing basis in shaping the things that happen at City Hall. We will ask you for your input before we make decisions. We will share information with you as much as possible in as timely a manner as possible. We were asked at the Fairfield debate the other night, what's the most important issue to you? And of course, there are lots of important issues that we need to take action on: affordability, climate change, supporting our local businesses, making better management of large-scale projects. Those are all important. But for me, if we are accountable to you, and if we engage in an ongoing basis in meaningful public participation, then we can tackle anything together. And I'm looking forward to that opportunity. Thank you. Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me to be part of this debate. I want to begin by saying that I was born and raised in Victoria, and I do care passionately about its future. Actually attended the Oakland Chapel off the street when I was growing up here in Victoria, and brings back fond memories of being in this area. One of the important issues that I've been hearing on the doorstep is about the rising property tax rates that have occurred in the last 6 years. 34% is what has occurred, where inflation has only gone up less than 9%. So my plan is to freeze the property tax rate for 4 years, because I know that will benefit homeowners, families, seniors, and renters. I've also been concerned about the Johnson Street Bridge replacement project. And since 2009, I have seen the original amount that was proposed to all of you of $63 million climb to $92.8 million. And I do not believe that is the end of it. Rather than using a time-tested template, we have an experimental, expensive project. And it's unique in its own way, but it's going to cost you more in the long run. So what I've said that, as your mayor, I will take control of that and provide executive oversight and make sure that it is completed at the lowest additional cost possible. The fact that an independent consultant who was hired to look and review this said no one was in charge is astounding to me. As I said, I grew up in this wonderful city. And what also has caused me dismay is walking downtown, seeing all the empty storefronts that are there. Those are small businesses, shop owners, abandoned buildings.
for me is abandoned dreams. And I don't think that's good enough. So I will work very hard as your mayor in the next 4 years to ensure we bring that back. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You may know me as a journalist in radio and television, and over the years I've asked some very tough questions of some of the politicians that are sitting on this panel today, and really basically get the answers so that you know exactly what's happening in your city, what's happening in the province. And answers have not been coming from City Hall. It's been a very closed and not an open and transparent government, and that's why I got into the race. And tonight I want to talk to you a little bit about leadership. I want you to ask you, who is going to be the best person that is going to lead the city over the next 4 years? Now, our current mayor really has shown that there is very little leadership, especially not on the Johnson Street Bridge, not on sewage, and not on creating a strong and vibrant downtown Victoria. And I believe we need change. That's what I'm hearing on the doorstep. When Ida Chong's leadership skills were put to test in getting provincial money for the Johnson Street Bridge, she didn't come up with a penny, but she was there for the photo op when the ribbon was cut. And Lisa helps. I mean, she's done some good work in this community, and I have to acknowledge that, but she's not really shown any real leadership on council. She may have had some great sounding ideas about working together, but what about, and she's created a youth poet laureate, or she's pushing through some speed limits against staff's advice. But really, I mean, is this the leadership that we need in this city? Ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you that I can provide that leadership. I'm ready to sit at the head of the CRD table, or sorry, at the head of the council table, not on CRD, and at the head of the police board. I've got a great team behind me. I've been speaking to experts or givers about these issues, and they are joining me on this journey. We've been looking at issues from heritage to addiction and issues of police matters, and we've been formulating a really good policy on this, and I ask you please go out to my website, stephenandrew.ca, and I'm going to have a bit more to say as we get involved in the big issues. Thank you.
Okay, now we're on to the question section, and I'm going to start up, as you do in most interviews, with a kind of a simple question. And we're going to go in reverse order. We just went through the introductions, so Stephen and Andrew get to go first. As mayor, what issue would be the most important to you and why?
As mayor, I think the most important issue is bringing balance to our governance and dealing with the ballooning tax burden that we've been having. I want to be able to deal with the social issues, but at the same time, I want to be able to deal with the business issues. Our business property tax, when I speak to businesses in the downtown area and elsewhere throughout the region, they say it is crippling. And I was on the street just the other day on Thursday, and there was another business closing. They said, we have to do something about it. We have to make ourselves competitive. Business makes up 50% of property tax here in Victoria. If we don't have a strong and thriving business, we are not going to be able to have that money to deal with social programs. So I want to bring balance to governance, and I also want to respect your tax dollars, knowing that really we cannot sustain dramatic increases over the next 4 years.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Well, I certainly want to begin by saying I appreciate what Stephen has said, because that's what I've been saying from the very start of my campaign. That to respect the taxpayers, we can start off by freezing your property tax rates. Because as I've said, they have gone up 34% in the past 6 years. If you have time to check my website, there is a calculator that I posted there for you. And if you were to enter in what your address and your house, you would see what you paid in 2008 and what you are now paying in 2014. You will be startled, but not in a very good way. And the freezing of the property tax rates is, as I said, important to not just for families and homeowners, but they're also important to renters, because those are passed down. They're also important to our small shop owners, because when they rent a space, all that is passed down to them. So it is important to consider the taxes that you are paying. Thank you.
And now we're going to set up.
Thank you. Well, I guess I answered that question already in terms of what I said at Fairfield the other night. So I'm going to take a bit of a different approach. I was at Vic High today and at Camosun College and talking about what does local government do. And one of the things that I was reminded of once again, after mapping on the whiteboard at Vic High for the grade 11 students, they told me everything that local government does, and boy are they knowledgeable. They talked about climate change, they talked about roads, they talked about housing affordability, they talked about treating our sewage. And then we started to get into the issues a little bit deeper. And I realized again, and hopefully they realized for the first time, how all of these issues are interconnected. And for me, that's the big issue. When you're thinking about building a new apartment building downtown, we need to think about that in terms of climate change. When we think about keeping housing affordability, we need to think not just about affordable housing, but as Ida and Stephen say, how can our seniors stay in their homes? So for me, the most important issue is that we cannot make decisions in isolation. All of the matters that the city does and takes care of are related, and that's important. Thank you.
You notice that Stephen didn't mention me as far as why you shouldn't vote for me, and that's because I'm an also-ran. That's basically how I've been treated in this campaign. I've been excluded from some of the downtown meetings. I wasn't even invited to participate. And I think if we're going to allow our electoral process, and to get to my answer, I think the electoral process itself needs to be reformed. I think we need to educate our candidates. I think our candidates, and we need to be able to prove that they're educated. I think we have to be able to prove that they understand what an OCP is, what a zoning bylaw is, how a meeting's supposed to be run, what Robert's rules are. And there's a lot of technical details about running council, and none of it's getting discussed. None of it's being tested. We're going to talk about John Street Bridge. We're going to talk about sewage, probably. There might be a few other issues, but we aren't talking about what really matters. And that's what I bring to the table.
Percent of children overall and more than half of children of single mothers live in poverty in Victoria. That's a social crisis. People, that's more than half. Can you believe, is this really Canada we're talking about? More than half of children of single mothers live in poverty, below the Stats Canada poverty level. These are Stats Canada numbers. These are not coming from some radical activist group. These are actual Stats Canada figures. I can't understand why this isn't the number one problem on everybody's mind. And there are ways of addressing it. The two suggestions in the changes for mayor platform are an affordable child care program and a living wage policy. In Quebec, they've had an provincial affordable child care program for, I don't know, since the 80s or the 70s. It used to be $5 a day, now it's up to $7. There's been a group promoting a $10 a day program in this province for years. There are things that can be done at the municipal level.
Dean Fortin.
Thank you, and I think the question has been interesting, but what's your one most important issue? And of course, what you've heard is from everyone here is that there's no one important issue. For me, we have to think holistically. Things are very complex. So if I had to put it into one sentence, it was sort of like, we need to build a sustainable and resilient city. We need a city that is socially just, one that is economically sound, one that is environmentally beneficial. We need to ensure that we continue to have a progressive city that moves forward on the issues that are important to you in Victoria. Housing, active transportation, a safe and vibrant downtown. And I'll just say, over the last 6 years, we have proven and we have shown results and movements on every one of those. And together, with your support, we're going to keep that going. Thank you, Joanne.
Okay, here comes another question. And we're just going to do reverse order. When I get to the next round of questions, I'm going to mix it up a bit. This question, I think, will show my bias a little bit as the chair of the Land Use Committee. So Dean will have the first crack at this, and we'll go back to you a little separately.
Do you believe citizens' involvement in land use decisions should be limited to developing local neighborhood plans and the official community plan? Does ongoing and direct involvement of neighborhood land use committees needlessly slow down the development process?
Yeah, four answers in that one. Four questions in that one. Let me put it this way. I was really proud to work at the Burnside Gorge Community Center for 17 years, and one of the things we worked really closely with was the Burnside Community Association and the Running Community Center. And together we helped build the Community Association network, having to make sure that there was community voice in the future. I think that this, without community voice, you do not make sustainable decisions. I think that if you cut out community, that really you're not creating the situation of building a sustainable community. What I've said, and I'll say it again, when you send things to good citizen-led committees, it makes good decisions better and makes bad decisions go away. It's important that we do not have a devolution of decisions away from council who are democratically elected, off to staff, that we need to make sure that the voice of the people are always there. In the plans, in the neighborhoods, at public hearings, out in the consultation. Again, you know, when you get 6,000 people involved in your official community plan, you're doing community consultation. You help build the vision for this city for the next 30 years.
It's been suggested to me that by answering every question, I end up diluting the changes for mayor message, which is the message about child poverty, and that's the last thing I want to do. I don't want to dilute that message. I want it to be loud and clear. I've been passing on some of the questions for that reason, and that's what I'm going to do here. I'm going to pass on this question.
Thank you very much. And all members of the panel are welcome to pass on questions to save time and maybe get some more questions. So thank you, changes. Jason Ross.
I was in Northern Rockies last summer for 2 weeks of horseback, and I met this guy, Wayne Sawchuk, and he almost single-handedly created this enormous area called the Musquapachika Management Area. And it's a protection area for wildlife and habitat, especially breeding areas, but it also has provisions for accommodating resource extraction, protection of First Nation territory and land, especially specific sites, laws of tourism, that sort of thing. And how he did it was he got all the different parties together and he organized a big meeting where they went over and said, okay, let's find the areas where there's no conflict and then let's get consensus. And then let's start taking the areas where there was a conflict and you go off in your different areas, talk about what you want, then come together and form some sort of compromise. And the reason why I'm mentioning this is because I think that's how planning should work. And I think the community should be the one that builds it. I think the residents in the community, the business owners, and the people who use the area should get together and talk about what they do and bring it to council, and then council deals with it and goes either way.
So I believe the question was, should citizen engagement in land use only be relegated to neighborhood plans and official community plans, and do I believe that land use committees slow down development and should be pushed aside? The answer to the first question is no. I think that neighborhood land use committees should be involved on an ongoing basis. And I guess the answer to question number two is also no. I don't believe that land use committees slow down development at all. What I think and what I've witnessed in the past 3 years as a counselor is that there's a siloed process. So the community association land use process, for the most part, works really well. The developer needs to go to the community first, the community has input, and only then can the developer bring their plans to City Hall. But then there's a lot of back and forth that happens, and my preference would be to see a process where city staff and the community association land use committee and the developer sit down together in one meeting at one time to work through some of the complex issues. That's what I'd like to see. So thanks for the great question.
Hi, Michelle.
Thanks very much. Well, I do believe citizen engagement involvement does need to happen
in a number of areas, and that's why you have your community associations. That's why about 25 years ago, they were established to allow for community involvement, community input, especially as we were seeing the city, the region actually changing, and as development was occurring in some of the more non-urban areas. So I would continue to believe that neighborhood associations, community associations should be involved. But what I would also say is that in terms of the land use committees, that if the terms of reference were clearly identified and that the developer community was aware of the engagement that was necessary, and that the professional staff, and you do have to rely on this, some really great professional staff who work in the city have involvement in that, I do believe you can come together and not have a back and forth and throw kind of situation, where all that does is provide inconsistency and it actually deters the additional neighborhood enhancements that I think you all would like to have.
Good answer.
Thank you, Andrew. This is a great question because we live in our communities. You all know that. I live in Burnside Gorge area. We know, we live there every day. We know what the issues are. And of course, land use committees should be involved in planning development. I think that's extremely important. I don't think it slows the process down. I do think, though, however, we need to provide some certainty for everybody involved, whether it be the neighborhood associations or the developer that's bringing it forward. So I'd like to see some guidelines, time guidelines put in place, and I would like to see city staff being able to usher them through, and that doesn't mean push them through, but give some certainty to the final development when a decision could be made. I also think you've heard today that the council is the voice of people. Well, only if they agree with council. An example is a situation in James Bay where a development came forward, the neighborhood association supported it 100%, sent out a letter supporting it, staff supported it. When it got in front of council, they completely rejected it, demand something else, sent it back to the neighborhood association, which the neighborhood association didn't like. So if it suits their voice, they will listen. If it doesn't, they don't. Thank you.
Okay, I'm going to change up the next round for a little bit. I'll let the timekeeper, you've got some time, Joanne. It can take a while. So before we start the next round, I want to read the following that I've taken from the Union of British Columbia Municipalities publication titled Local Government in British Columbia. And it reads, the major policy decisions in a municipality are made by the elected council, which consists of the mayor and councillors. A municipal council is a continuing body that speaks with one voice. It cannot be bound by the mayor or an individual member. Members are bound to act in good faith. They must participate in council meetings, and they must not disclose confidential information. The mayor is expected to exercise leadership, but except for some appointment and agenda setting authority, he or she is for policy making purposes just another member of council. So this tells me that the mayor has to be a person who can express their ideas, debate fully. And so this is where I'm changing up the format a little bit. So what I've done is I've gone to each of these people's platforms and I've lifted out some stuff in their platform and I formed a question around that. And I'm going to allow them to answer that question, and then all the other people on the panel will get to comment on that answer. So we're kind of getting a quasi-debate. And remember, they do have a 30-second rebuttal, one only. And if you have to the panelists, if you have, if I've misconstrued it or you've changed your mind as a result of events, you know, modify the question a little bit. Okay, work for you. But remember, everybody's going to get to comment on it. And so we drew lots to see who goes first. And the first person was Stephen Andrew. And I'll give you a copy of this, Stephen, as well. It's pretty brief. Okay. So on Stephen's website, it says, the city is currently layered up in the approval process. We need to be a catalyst so that quality developments that will enliven our city can move quickly through the process. My question is, and it's a couple of questions, what do you mean by quality developments? Who or through what process determines what a quality development is?
One minute. Okay, so what I mean by quality, says many different questions here. What do I mean by quality development? I mean a quality development that fits the official community plan, it fits the neighborhood requirements. That's what I'm saying about a quality development, one that fits all those levels. Who or through what process determines what a quality development is? I think that explains it. I didn't get to your last question was why. You added another question there.
No, that was it. Both questions.
Okay, so moving it through the process, I would just like to see a facilitator come in, because some of the developments or the applications on developments are not, they don't fit the OCP effectively, or they may not fit the neighborhood plans. I would like to see a facilitator take the application through, make sure that it meets all of those requirements before it comes out, so that really we're not wasting your time and we're not wasting the developer's time. Thank you.
Next person to respond is going to be Jason Ross.
Do I get a minute as well?
Yes, you do. Everybody gets a minute to respond.
All right, thank you. I think the hardest part about determining what a faulty development is the fact that we've got three main sets of bylaws that relate to what development can occur. You got your zoning bylaws, you've got your neighborhood plans, and you've got the efficient community plan, and those three are not in agreement for a lot of things. And in particular, the neighborhood plans, which haven't been updated in some cases decades. And we need to have a conversation very soon where we can take, go neighborhood by neighborhood and take all the information that talks about, here's what the local village is, here's what the zoning is for each of the properties, here's what the neighborhood plan says is going to happen, and here's what the OCP says. And find out what the conflicts are and lay it all out so that we at least have a clear picture of what is it that we're telling developers that is in conflict with itself just because we've got three different sets of rules. And we should have that conversation with the neighborhoods to say, what is it that you see of these things that doesn't fit with what your image of this community should be? And build that together.
Thank you. So for me, a quality development, the OCP is a good guideline. But a quality development is one that is embraced by the neighborhood, that is profitable for the developer, and that's going to be standing proudly in our city for a long time. A quality development, you can tell by the look and feel. And I'm not going to name non-quality developments, but if you walk, for example, into the Atrium building, you can feel this is a quality development. It invites the public, it has a big street interface, rail yards, Dockside Green, Selkirk, those are all examples of quality developments. So for me, the process ends up in the product. And so how do we get to a quality development? I've talked about this a little bit already. We involve the neighborhood and we create a process just like the one we have with a little bit of tweaking where everybody's voices, both the people who are going to live beside or in the development and the cities and the developers, are part of forming the quality process. So quality process ends up in a quality development. That's been my experience. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I have seen of developments, the ones that are deemed to be quality are the ones that have had neighborhood involvement, are the ones that have also provided for amenities. And the amenity doesn't necessarily have to be a playground or a park, but sometimes that neighborhood would like places for small shops, a laundromat, a dog grooming place. But what it means is that that development has been accepted by the neighborhood, and the developer knows going in what he or she is to provide for that neighborhood after having some consultation. What's important, I believe, though, is also that the process should be consistent so that even within your own city, you're not wondering from one area to another what it's going to be. And so there should be clarity. That way, I believe everybody wins. Thank you.
Thank you. What's a quality? Gosh, that was the fastest thing ever. Quality development. Let's start off with recognizing excellence in design should be our expectation. This should not be the exception. We need to make sure that all of our developments moving forward have green features built into that. They must meet those standards if we're going to make any difference in change around how we're affecting our climate and how we're moving and building our cities. Finally, it has to fit within the community. it can be evolutionary, but it shouldn't be revolutionary. Half a lap in a larger sense. Revolution just changes who's at the top. It really never changes what's going on. But we saw in the 70s, Mayor from Oak Bay came in, and they jammed in Orchard Huts over the community objections in Oak Bay. In James Bay. And they jammed in View Towers, all these huge towers. And the community rightly rose up and stopped all development for 30 years. You must work. So when you start to hear people saying, let's expedite it, let's move it, let's move these developments happen, recognize that for true sustainable development, it has to be in conjunction with the community moving forward in a sustainable way.
Changes the crown. Changes is going to pass on this question.
Thank you, Changes. So the next question's directed to Jason Ross, and I realize that as I look at these, unless I do a big run-on sentence, it is kind of three questions. So, Jason, on his website, it reads, I also believe in citizen-driven government, and I want to use the 24/7 nature of the internet to build ongoing conversations that encourage cooperation and build consensus about difficult issues. My question is, please explain how you see this working. How would you know when you have reached consensus? Would it involve staff resources? And I'll pass the question down to you just to...
Well, let's go in reverse order, because I don't think it needs to involve staff resources. I think all you need are a few cameras and a willingness for people to get together and talk, to have a conversation. And if you record the information, you can post it online on YouTube. YouTube allows you to post hour-long meetings, multiple hours. I posted a six-hour council meeting. Because I went to council. When I got involved in this whole process last election, I was bringing my cameras and recording these meetings because I thought they were important. And then I went to council meetings and did the same thing because Victoria wasn't doing it. And they only started doing it after I started showing up and doing it on a regular basis. So, and I think any conversation that's in a closed room where once the people disperse, the information goes away, is a poor meeting. I think we should be dealing online all the time. Our residents association should be online. And it can be cheap if people pitch in. If there are people who feel that this should be done, then you can volunteer, man a camera, learn editing, post online. We can do this as a community if we all work together.
Okay, I'll let Andrew speak next. This is getting complicated to figure out who speaks next. Steve. I knew I was going to do that once tonight.
I'll be very brief. I think engagement is very important. I've spent my entire career doing that, and I think that it works. And for Jason to say it's not going to require staff resources, I think we are kidding ourselves. The city of Victoria has worked on increasing engagement, but it's also ballooned its communications department to the point, really, where I think it's out of control and we need to do something about it. So if it's real communication, if we are communicating effectively with you on a regular basis, being open and transparent, letting you know what made it onto the agenda and also what didn't, then you can give us that communication back, that feedback, that we can move forward. But I have to say that any expansion of any communications project is going to take resources. And I would just like to consider that, of course, resources means time and it means money.
Jason, you want to do your rebuttal now?
I think I can do my rebuttal right now.
Okay.
Yes, there could be opportunities for staff to get involved, but if you look at the way the communications department communicates with the city, you'll recognize that it's not effective. It doesn't actually give you any detail. It gives you glossy, good-looking information that doesn't actually tell you anything about what's actually happening.
Right on.
And we don't need staff. We don't need them as a crutch. If people are interested in this, they'll get together and we'll talk. I just want to have people throw cameras on, get mics on them, and have the conversation live online. Talk on Facebook, talk on Twitter, and use the tools that are free on the internet to share and keep the conversation going.
Thank you. Okay, now going to be, Lisa, do you need me to repeat that string of questions again?
It's okay, we have the question here. First of all, for the record, we don't have a communications department anymore, just so everybody knows. It's the Department of Public Engagement and Strategic Planning. So we're shifting. We've heard very loud and clear that what was coming out wasn't acceptable, and so we're slowly starting to make some changes, and it's the citizen engagement and strategic planning, which I think is important. I think that we need to, and I agree with a lot of what Jason said, we need participatory democracy. That doesn't mean that once every 4 years you come to the polls. It means that we engage you in a continuous is that it? No, I get a minute. It wasn't in a rebuttal. Okay, that's okay. I'll go for another 30 seconds. So two concrete ways, I can keep track of time in my head, two concrete ways that the city can do this is we've just recently launched a platform called Have Your Say Victoria. Right now we use it for big engagement questions. There's no reason, with very limited staff resources, that every 2 weeks we can't post our agenda up there and say, have your say, Victoria, weigh in on these items, and the responses don't need to be filtered through staff. They can come right to council into our email boxes. That way it gives you, every 2 weeks, with an existing platform that's already there, an opportunity to weigh in. So that's one idea. My next one will have to come later because I can tell 30 seconds is about to go quickly. Thank you.
Thank you. And one of the things which we've really been proud of bringing in over the last 6 years is developing and bringing in what's known as a citizen engagement strategy, where we have a commitment to go out and talk to you about all the things that are important. And yes, we have land use decisions that come in, and we meet every 2 weeks at council, and you have that opportunity to put in, and we have the land use process. But when it comes to big things, for example, when we built the OCP, when we talked about how we're going to visit our city over the next 30 years, what it's going to look like, we went out and we talked to 6,000 people under a new site link. We went out and talked out to more than 2,800 people, helped build those plans. I just want to say this. I remember just being across the road in Vic High, and we went out and we talked to kids because it's going to be their city. And we were meeting with them. And I said, what do you want your city to be? And some kid stands up, hats on backwards, says, I want more skate parks. And I looked at him and I said, so when you're 30 years from now, you're going to be in that skate park? And the kids stopped, and then he reflected and he said, no, but I'll be taking my kids there. It's important we go out and engage people where they are.
Thank you. Well, firstly, I would like to acknowledge Jason's idea, because I think what he's trying to do is basically have City Hall be accountable to all of you as citizens, to offer more transparency. Because what I've also been hearing is that there have been too many secretive meetings, and citizens need to know how their council is debating and what they're discussing. So I think it is a good idea that Jason suggested. And with regards to staff resources, you know, I've seen it where you can actually have people involved or manning the cameras. You can get students from the high schools and students from the colleges because they want to learn how to be behind the camera. I think that can work as a volunteer process for them. But I would challenge a comment made by Lisa about changing the name. Changing the name of communications doesn't change the spots and what it does. And I don't know why we need such a large budget for a population of 83,000 people.
Okay, we're using a rebuttal here.
So I have spoken to City Hall as a journalist for 15, maybe 20 years, and I can tell you that about 15, 20 years ago, there was only one person, the band's executive assistant. And it really is, you can call it whatever you like, public engagement or anything. And by the way, the government did the same thing. They renamed their communications department engagement. You've still got six people sitting in it. The question really becomes, if you're asked a question, are you going to answer it? And most time, these politicians don't.
Well, this is starting to work, isn't it? A little bit. Maybe we should add some, we've got quite a bit of time, maybe we should add some more rebuttals, you know. We'll take a poll after they're all done through them all. Okay, now it changes the climate.
Jason's right that we need to revitalize democracy, We need democratic reform, electoral reform, and he's right that we need to explore all different kinds of ways of doing that too. And obviously the internet, modern communication technology holds vast potential for that sort of thing. And it's 24/7, you can do it right from your bedroom, from your kitchen table, wherever you're comfortable. I really think we do need more forms, more direct democracy, more integrated ways of forms of participatory democracy into the system. The need for this is made obvious when you consider the incredible levels of voter turnout or non-voter turnout. People are obviously alienated from the system. The system lacks meaning for them. It's not engaging. We need to incorporate other methods of democracy, other ways of enacting democracy that are more engaging for people alongside existing systems. And there are all kinds of ways of doing that. The internet holds a lot of potential for that. Thanks.
The last question is for Lisa Helps, and I will get to that.
Could you just pass this
down,
please?
It's a bit of a lengthy one, because if you've been to Lisa's website...
I've got detail.
She's got detail. So, in looking at Lisa's website, I looked at only her one-year commitments only. And I only selected a few of them. Transform City Hall from an organization that is managed as a series of department silos to an organization that is managed as a system. Implement use of Have Your Say Victoria, the city's interactive web platform. Create a public participation plan. Appoint the mayor's economics development cabinet. Improve city's processes and reduce processing time. Create an enterprise facilitator position. Develop pocket parks and appropriate parking spaces on city streets. Update the City of Victoria's Bicycle Master Plan, appoint the Mayor's Creative City Cabinet, and work to rebuild the city's relationship with the municipalities around the region and with the provincial government. So here's my series of questions on this. Assuming the majority of these will require staff support and involvement, possibly a budget, and could bump other items off the work plan, how will you convince your council members to support you doing any or all of this?
Fantastic question. And this is where we really get to talk about leadership. So as a councillor, like we heard from David doing his homework and reading the UBCM website, the mayor is just one vote on council. That's true. And as a councillor, I've been one vote there at the table for the last 3 years. And almost every motion that I've brought forward, with some exceptions, have passed. Why? Because I don't just make stuff up out of my own head. These ideas didn't just come from my own head. They came from intensive 3 years of listening. And at the council table, before I write a motion, I listen to what you're saying, what Jeff's saying, Chris is saying. Listen to what everybody's saying, and I make sure that when I put forward a motion, there are other people's ideas represented in it too. That's my leadership style. That's why the motions that I've made as councillor have passed, and that's why I'm looking forward to sitting down with my council after the election, hearing what their priorities are and how they fit with some of these ideas. So thank you very much for the question, David. I really appreciate it.
Thanks very much. And, you know, a number of areas that I guess Lisa wants to pursue, but I think one of the most important matters that occurred during her term was dealing with the Johnson Street Bridge replacement project, the Blue Bridge project as we all know it, and the financial fiasco that it has been. So, you know, I'm finding it hard to understand how she would be able to convince her council when she wasn't able to convince council to provide all that additional information that is needed as to how much additional money we're going to be looking at. You know, I recently was able to release a report done by an independent engineer who said we could be faced with another $11 to $17 million. Now, it's all posted on the public website, I understand that, but not everyday persons would go to that website and understand it in a comprehensive way. Took this independent engineer the time and effort to put it together, and I'm thankful for that. And so I would have just suggested, at least your leadership style should have demanded that be brought forward.
Can I have my rebuttal now?
Sure,
was released. So the reason that Ida has the data that she has to write her report with her independent engineer is because from the moment I sat down at that council table, I've been asking questions and demanding answers on the Johnson Street Bridge project. The reason that the information is made public is because we pushed as a council to make it public as soon as possible, especially after our new city manager started, and he has a different commitment to public participation and transparency than our old city manager did. I've asked the questions. That's why Ida has the information. I've taken as much leadership as I can, and I assumed that someone was in charge. I assumed there was a project schedule, and I assumed that the mayor was in charge of making sure that those things happened. Thanks, Ida.
It's Dean's turn. Well, I guess it's kind of like, so, as mayor, which I love, is the citizens say, this is the people you work with for the next 3 years. And you have to bring them together. And they're a diverse group of people who have gone through. And it's about bringing them together, building a strategic plan, moving forward on those ones that you build consensus on, and making things happen. And it's been fun. It was fun in 2008. It's been fun in 2011. I have to point this out. When Lisa says, well, everything I brought forward has been enacted, I actually want to take issue with that. Lisa brought forward a motion to cut our affordable housing trust fund. We turned that back. Lisa brought forward a motion to cut the grants to charities and to social service agencies to save money. We had to organize and push that back. And Lisa put forward a proposal to close the crystal pool. So, no, we didn't agree with all of the things that she put forward. And we had to organize and make sure that her voices were heard. So she hears them now, and she's putting it forward. But it comes down to when the push comes to shove, you need to understand what the values are behind when people are making decisions. So those are the ones.
Changes the clown.
We hear a lot about leadership in a context like this. Something that's sort of related to leadership, which is sort of part of what I'm doing here, which I don't actually talk about very much, involves the clown suit and the largely concealed identity. You'll notice that the name on the card here is not my real name, it's Changes the Clown. All of this is intended to deflect attention away from the individual and away from the focus on personality in politics, which I think is absolutely inappropriate. The fascination with personality, with individuals, with the person in the clown suit, at the expense of careful analysis of ideas. All this is distracting, and ultimately it becomes a showbiz sort of production. You know, election campaign runs the danger of becoming a reality show, and the vote itself is a popularity contest, which is ridiculous. It's a really absolutely shallow form of democracy. Okay, thanks.
The question was about transforming City Hall, I think, and if you have a look at my brochure, you see what I'm going to do is set councillors to deal with specific key issues such as finance and efficiency, economic development, the list goes on. You can have a look at the brochure or go to my website, stephenandrew.ca. They will develop policy along with the community and experts and then bring it forward to the council table, and when we get a win, I am going to be standing beside that councillor and giving them the credit for what they're doing, because that's the work. We should nurture our council, make them shine, and have a collaborative process. Also, in the community, the hall meetings, I'm going to rotate the chair in every meeting so that everyone has a team spirit at the table, despite their political or their partisan background. They will have to realize we are there to do a job. We are elected as a council, and we must act as a council. Thank you.
Jason Ross.
I believe one of the parts of the question, I've got it right here, is how you convince your council members to support you with doing any or all of this. And I think my perspective has always been, it's not what you choose to do, it's how you do it. And we should be focusing on the stuff that's the easy, the low-hanging fruit. What's going to get us, going to take the least amount of time, the least amount of money to get us the biggest bang? And when we take up on a project, we should be identifying what are the risks up front, and we should be tracking what those are, We should be monitoring what happens around the environment of what those projects are taking place to see if it changes. And we should be, after we complete something, we should be analyzing, what did we learn? What did we do right? What did we do wrong? And roll that into our future decisions. And those type of, that sort of detail, we aren't breaking apart the project or whatever it is we're trying to tackle into all its constituent parts and looking at, does this make sense? What information are we missing? We should be doing a completely thorough job of what we're doing at council, and not whatever it is that's going on now.
Okay, the next question is going to be for Ida Chong, and to the candidates. If I miss one of you in the response, can you give the juggling match here for me, trying to keep who's spoken and who hasn't? Okay, so I took this from Ida's strong plan for a strong capital city document. Victoria plans to significantly limit the property tax exemptions, known as permissive exemptions, that are available from nonprofits. Some community groups could lose up to 90% of the permissive tax exemption support that they currently rely on. Later on, Ida says, as mayor, Ida will protect taxpayers by freezing Victoria's property no rates for 4 years, protect property tax exemptions for nonprofit groups and charities, increase on-street police presence downtown. So, two questions. Will you have to cut anything in order to pay for these changes? And how will you convince your council members to support you in doing this?
Thank you. So the first part of the question about having to cut anything, and I know it is counterintuitive to believe that when you freeze property tax rates, that you automatically have to make reductions in your spending elsewhere. I will not be making any reductions in police, fire, core, central services, engineering, parks, those areas. What I will be doing is working to ensure we grow our tax base. There are additional dollars that are available through increased development, which the city has already approved. The question is, when are those coming in? Are there delays that are being caused as a result of inertia at City Hall? We have so many downtown empty spaces. That is another area that we need to pursue. And with regard to the on-street police presence, I think that too is critically important. I can tell you that will not require additional dollars. It will just require a change of deployment.
Okay. Ida, do you want to pass it down to Dean and so that he can see it? Just maybe we should do that for all of them. They were doing it that at the end of the table. So Dean, you're next.
So to a certain extent, honestly, a lot of us are trying to figure out what Ida's really trying to say. Because if she's saying, I'm going to freeze tax rates, but it's not going to make any difference whatsoever, I mean, your instinct is saying, then why are you doing that if it's not making anything different? Fundamentally, we think it is just that. It's code for we are going to freeze taxes. And what that really means is, over the next 3 years, that's a $20 million cut. That's cuts to community centers, senior centers, libraries, police. That is fundamental, the damage that's going to happen there. And we need to remind everyone that we don't run deficits at City. I know it's easy at the province for them to build up $66 billion in debt and credit cards that God knows how we're ever going to pay that off. We don't do that in the city. What we've done over the last 6 years is prudently add 1% tax increase every year to our normal 1.82%, which is inflation, to build up our infrastructure reserves from $75 million to $125 million, because I don't believe, and our city council doesn't believe, and that includes Lisa, that we don't believe that we should mortgage our children's future. That's why this is such a dangerous and radical plan. It's all about us.
Changes the climate.
Changes agrees that there are definitely places to identify savings in the municipal budget. I have a brief list here, which I put together basically off the top of my head, involving things like policing of homeless people, policing of cannabis users, the police vehicle budget. I don't know how many full-size SUVs there are in the fleet, but I don't know how many they really need to produce Victoria. The NASCARs that they drive around town are incredible, too. I don't know what the horsepower is. It's crazy. It might be cool, you could say. Anyway, I mean, think of the police cars that they drive in Europe, at least small sports cars and so on. Anyway, other things would be senior management salaries and excluded staff. The roadwork budget, I don't know, maybe this is just me, but I see a lot of roadwork going on that doesn't seem necessary, could at least be delayed when there's a social crisis in our community. You know, one in two children of single mothers, and overall 20% of children living in poverty.
I'm surprised by Ida's plan, because she's an accountant, and anyone would know that when you put a budget together, you miss forecasts, and clearly she hasn't articulated what the forecast of that increased revenue is going to be over the next 4 years as mayor. So the bottom line is, rather than say freeze taxes, I'm going to limit tax increases so that we can deal with the infrastructure problems that we have. The mayor has just said that he's not going to mortgage our children's future, but just ladies and gentlemen, we have three times more debt than our neighboring municipalities, and that is a concern. And I just also want to point out that we can grow our tax base, and I believe that's going to happen, and it's going to take some time. And as we've seen with the TIP program, which is the grant program to restore heritage buildings, that took a 10-year plan. So any ideas that we have may take at least 2, 3, 4, 5 years before they come online. So I'm very weary when we say we're going to freeze taxes. Thank you.
Thank you. So I guess we're just responding.
Sorry,
Lisa.
Yeah, I'm right here from the side of the table. I agree.
It is.
So I'm going to try and kill two birds with one stone, my main topic of this subject is cheap, gimmicky politics. I don't like cheap, gimmicky politics, and I think to just blindly say you're going to freeze property tax at zero, I mean, is a disservice. Ms. Quinnell did that this last term. They did it every 3 years. They did it. And the last budget we sat in and watched. And they're bending over backwards trying to find ways to cut this and that just so they could get that artificial freeze tax. And I think it's cheap and gimmicky. And so is what Dean said. Yes, the city doesn't run a deficit because you're not legally allowed to run a deficit. No city in the province of BC runs deficit. It's part of the law that's at the provincial level. So let's talk honestly and frankly and stop trying to massage the message and make some sort of political stance.
Thank you.
Lisa.
Thank you. I'm not going to go into detail here, but I would encourage you to go to my website and read my blog post called Property Taxes 101. And there you'll find an interesting analysis of the proposal to freeze property tax rates. But more importantly, you can look at my plan for the next 4 years, which involves keeping property taxes in line with inflation, not by cutting and slashing services, because I don't want to do that and I don't believe we need to do that, but by asking our frontline workers who know their jobs better than any of their managers where to find savings. And from talking to our workers one-on-one, they've got lots of good ideas. In the blog post on Property Taxes 101, look for the story that I tell about the city of Saskatoon and how they were able to innovate and drive creativity through every level of their organization and find savings. That's what I look forward to doing. Thank you.
Ida has requested a rebuttal.
Thank you. Well, it's really interesting because you're right. I am the only accountant here, and I do know how to read a set of books. And in fact, I have looked at the city financial information. And I would not have made that commitment if I did not believe it could be done, and at the same time protecting our core essential services. What I'm concerned about, too, what I hear about Lisa is her property tax on one, which I have looked at, which actually isn't very comprehensive. But what I just heard her say is that she agrees that we could find savings. Well, if we're going to find savings, which is also what was required, then why do we have to keep increasing your property tax rates?
Good point.
Okay, so we're on to the next question, and this one is for Dean Fortin.
So it was kind of challenging finding a question because Dean's website does not have a lot of promises on it.
So took it all off.
So here's what I managed to find. So on your website, Dean, after you listed a number of achievements, you say, "We've done all this while increasing our infrastructure reserves and bringing in the lowest tax increase in 14 years. My question, two questions really, will you be able to continue doing these two things over the next 4 years? And how will you do that?"
So one of the things we've been very successful at the City of Victoria is actually over the last 6 years recognizing, and it's the only time I get to use Barack Obama and myself in the same sentence. In November of 2008, myself and Barack Obama got elected, and then the economy tanked. Over the last 6 years, we recognized that we had to tighten belts, that we recognized the economy was really a major concern. And so we've lowered the property tax increase, and I get it, it's an increase as opposed to just freezing it. Because it's important that we continue investing in key services that are important to you. Every year, over the last 6 years, we've lowered those property tax increases, and this year is the lowest property tax increase in 14 years. I believe that next year will be better. This year we've issued $300 million in building permits in the downtown. That'll equate to an extra $1.5 to $3 million in new revenue that'll allow us to continue to do that, continue to increase investment in services that you're telling us are really important and you want to see more of. So we are, that building boom that we've led in our downtown is paying off for you and for I and everyone in the future.
Okay, changes the clown.
Changes, I'll pass on this question.
Yeah, changes.
So now we're to Stephen Andrew.
As a journalist, I would be a bit of a cynic if I thought that it was rather opportunistic that we had the lowest tax increase in 14 years in election year. Why won't we get that in year two? And that would be an interesting question to answer down the road. Maybe the mayor can answer that in the rebuttal. But let's talk about the building boom and the money that that's bringing on. You know that we have debt, and anyone who has a credit card knows you get revolving credit and interest on that debt. We need to reduce our debt so that we can free up more of the dollars down the road to pay for the programs that we need in this city. And we need to get a handle on it. And if you're walking around town with three times more debt than neighboring municipalities, it is going to constrict plans for the future. So I think what we need to do is deal with the infrastructure that we can with minimal tax increases, and then we need to get our debt down so that we can have more money to spread around down the road.
Jason Ross.
I'm looking at this question and I'm trying to figure if Dean actually answered it. And that's the problem that I have with when he speaks, is I don't know what he's saying. I don't understand, because it goes on to this political battle speak, and it's like last meeting, you guys weren't there, I don't think most of you, and we had three questions directed at him, and all of us asked a question, and he didn't answer any of them. And I don't understand why we keep electing a person who can't answer a direct question. And anybody else on this table, I think, is more qualified to be able to do this job.
Okay, Lisa Helps.
Sorry, I'm just suggesting, that's quite a statement to make. I wasn't going to comment on this because, you know, there's not really that much to say. Yes, we need to increase our infrastructure reserves and keep limiting tax increases. But one thing, you know, that I guess point out, I took a risk on my website by putting up a whole bunch of detail, a very detailed plan that says in year one, you can expect this. In year two, you can expect this, of course, with the will of my council. So one of the things I would like to request of our mayor is that we get a little bit more detail on his site about what his plans are for the next 4 years. So I guess that's my comment on this question. Thank you.
Ida Chong.
Thanks very much. Well, I still say 34%
property tax rate increase over 6 years is too high. But the fact that the mayor has also indicated that there's more revenues coming in because there is more building, well, that just goes to the point. Why do we have to keep going after your pocket? And that is about growing the economy. That is about finding other sources of revenue without having coming back to your pocket time after time. I'm also intrigued about the reserves that are being built up. Well, if I talk to people on the doorsteps, they're wondering, why have we not invested in critical infrastructure? So if the reserves are being built up, where is the plan to actually implement the use of those reserves? I'm wondering whether that reserve is going to have to be used to pay for the Blue Bridge.
Yeah. Okay, changes the clown.
Changes a pass on this question.
Okay. And the next question is for changes the clown. Okay, so I looked at his platform. And he says the following: participatory budgeting, a process empowering ordinary community members to participate in decision-making regarding budget expenditures. Could you expand on how we would do this? And just talk about what you mean by it exactly.
This is related again to the question of democratic reform. A number of people have been talking about that. I really do think we need to explore new ways of enacting democracy, and there are hundreds of them out there. A lot of them are, you know, they're things that people aren't all that familiar with because they can't be manipulated and controlled by money in the way that simple electoral politics can be. So this is participatory budgeting is a form of direct democracy, a way of incorporating participatory democracy into the municipal budgeting process. And it's been in place in, the sort of prototypical case that everybody talks about is in Porto Alegre, Brazil, where it's been in place for decades. But there are places in the U.S. where it's in place, Chicago, Boston, and other cities, and also aspects of school board. There are a number of school board organizations in Canada that use this.
Stephen Andrew. Okay. Jason Ross.
Changes, do you have anything else you want to read there? I'll read it. Could use my time. Otherwise, I'll pass. Okay. I just want to read.
Lisa Helps.
Thank you. Participatory budgeting is something that I'm very passionate about and very excited about. Our council this year has adopted a new budgeting process brought to us by our city manager. And in 2015, we're going to do a much better job than we have in the past at asking for your input. And in 2016, with your input from 2015, we're actually going to be implementing participatory budgeting in Victoria. What this means is that you have a direct say on a certain portion of the city's budget. I was up in Tofino helping the mayor of Tofino and their finance committee implement participatory budgeting up there. They're the first municipality in British Columbia that's doing it. They took $20,000 of their grant budget and they're turning it over to their citizens to say, you help us decide. So I'm really looking forward to seeing, obviously we've got a bigger budget than Tofino. Their whole budget up there is $5 million for the year. But I'm looking forward to 2016 when we will implement some form of participatory budgeting and you'll be able to directly have a say in how your dollars are spent. Thank you.
Well, thanks, Changes, for bringing that up, because I do think participatory budgeting can be achieved. And what I was dismayed about this year, though, is what has happened at City Hall. With all the talk that's going on about being open and transparent, and I hear about more secret meetings, I was dismayed to hear that the budget deliberation this past year, the public had 10 days to review and comment, a $209 million budget, and then barely 2 hours of public consultation was provided for. So obviously, we need to do better. I would also like to encourage looking at providing a sufficient amount of time to review it with multiple public consultation opportunities. And they could be by virtual town halls, they could be, use of other technology. It's out there, and people do want to have their say, and they should.
Dean Fortin.
Thank you. I love participating in budgeting. I think it's extremely important. I think always in our budgeting, we want to look for continuous improvement and how we can do things better. I think we need to say, and maybe perhaps under different words, but we've been working on participatory budgeting for the city for probably for the past 20 years, a lot of it coming out of the community associations. The City of Victoria and the community associations have been early leaders in this. Lisa talks about the community grants, but I just want to remind everybody, of course, that we have community grants where we have special grants, you have where you can decide what's important for you. There's matching grants that you decide what's important for you in this neighborhood or next neighborhood, and you can see in the sheet that we've handed out all the matching grants that we're doing. We've been making sure that community has had a voice. It's also important where we recognize that community centers provide an opportunity for community voices. Unlike other cities, our community centers are run by community associations and community groups. You determine how those recreation dollars are spent in your community, in your neighborhood. We're going to continue to keep working on it. I will say this, Ida may not, I doubt if she watched the 2 hours that the webcasting of our budget, but we also went to three different community centers, and over the last 6 years, every year we've been out in every community center in Crystal Pool.
That's got through the questions that were based on what's on people's websites. So we're now going into the other questions we have. We're doing great on the time. It's only 8:25. But I want to offer a chance for any rebuttals before we move on to another round. There's still some people have some rebuttals left. Hearing no takers, we'll move on. Yes?
I'm wondering if there's a possibility of questions from the floor.
I've got quite a few questions to plow through here that people have submitted, and I've
but
got from others.
We're talking about participatory democracy.
Certainly, if we get done through this before 9 o'clock, certainly. Or if you want to, well,
we will stay after.
Okay.
Okay. I will stay after the rest.
Okay. Question. I'm just gonna. You all get a chance to answer this question. It's not directed at anybody. Recent media reports have highlighted a growing number of homeless seniors having to rely on our shelters. What will you do to deal with this challenge? And we'll start with Stephen Andrew.
Well, I think the first thing we need to do is, the first thing I would like to do, we have an issue that we don't fully grasp how bad it is. I would like to have an effective homelessness count. Now, I'd like to get that moving as quick as possible after I'm in the mayor's office so we know exactly what we're dealing with. And we need to start using regional resources. Saanich has just opened up starting on a project to deal with homeless people in the senior demographic. The other thing that I have discovered as well. The other thing that I would like to deal with, there are other organizations, federal organizations, by the way, for instance, if we're dealing with some seniors have had military...
15 seconds.
Okay. Some seniors have had military involvement in the past, and we could be using the resources of the federal government to help out those. So I think we have to look at creative solutions to come to the table as quickly as possible and deal with those. But we first have to identify, I think, exactly what the real problem is. How bad it is, I should say. Excuse me.
Okay, next one, Jason Ross.
I wish I knew more about this issue to be able to talk about it in an informed fashion. And again, this is sadly one of the areas that I don't have the expertise in, but I feel strongly that there should be things done about it. And I think the community has some of the best answers. So, to go on a theme, the idea is that we go and we talk about this, and we have members of the public, we have organizations come forward and bring what the options are and see what we can do. But again, best bang for the buck. What can we do that's cheap, effective, and actually gets some sort of real result in a quick period of time?
Lisa Helps.
Thank you. This is where property taxes actually become really important and keeping them at a reasonable rate, inflation or less. One of the things that seniors fear is being taxed out of their homes. And I hear that on the doorstep a lot. It's very real. The other thing is, this is going to get worse, not better. In the next 15 years, there's going to be one working person for every 2.1 seniors in this region. So this is a problem that's getting worse and that needs attention. I agree with Stephen. What we need are creative new solutions in addition to the ones that we've already been implementing. So we continue to fund nonprofit housing providers to build more affordable housing, absolutely. And again, if you go to my website, you'll see in year three, I propose that we look at maybe increasing the amount that we give to the city's Affordable Housing Trust Fund. We also need to get more creative in terms of partnering with the private sector and turning some private sector units into affordable housing. Just like that, again, there's more details on my website. I can't cover it in a minute. It's a really, really important question.
Dean Fortney.
Homeless seniors is one of the growing areas of populations that we have huge concerns with, the other one being youth. When Oak Bay turned down twice the expansion of Oak Bay Homes, we went out as a city, as an individual, we said, let's put those in, and we found a space in Victoria for those senior care homes, which are now going into the on Hillside and the Blanchard Quadra area. It does allow an opportunity that the Baptist Housing, who's moving all those up there, also controls the central care home. We are meeting with BC Housing to transform that central care home on Jamison Street just into low-cost senior housing. Doesn't need to have care, just seniors that need to be able to afford a place of 300. That's 100 units that we can move forward. Right. We're committed over the next 4 years to bring in 200 units of housing with supports, to bring in 1,500 units of affordable housing. And just last week, Mayor and Council moved forward 175 affordable and low-income housing in Midwest and in the Burnside area by by the arena. We can make it happen. We have been making it happen. We have a plan and it's working. We can continue this.
Here's the plan.
Doing child poverty activism, I find that people will often take issue with the category of child poverty. People often want to point out that child poverty is really family poverty. That's absolutely true. Another category that people often bring up is senior poverty or elder poverty. And I just, every time they do, I just have to agree that this is screaming out for more attention. I mean, it breaks my heart to hear some of the stories. I mean, I remember what one woman in her 70s told me about how she had broken her glasses, like a year before or something, and was unable to replace them. So this is a woman living with broken glasses for a year, you know, indefinitely. What's going on here? The changes for mayor platform includes two things to address child poverty. One is affordable childcare, another is living wage. A third leg of a more comprehensive approach to addressing poverty involves social housing. Changes is here to talk about things that other people are not talking about. Other people are talking about social housing, so that's not on the changes platform. Just for that reason.
Okay, the next question. There's a number of boarded up residential buildings. Thank you. Glad you called me on that. I knew it was going to happen. I had a child, sorry.
Thanks very much. Well, first of all, I want to say, Lisa, I do feel it's a bit disingenuous of you when you say, on the one hand, seniors are worried about staying in their homes because of increasing property taxes. Then on the other hand, you're saying that it's okay to increase property tax rates. I have talked to a senior in her home, and she has been having to defer her property taxes because of the 34% increase in property tax rates over 6 years. So that's first and foremost. If you do believe that seniors are worried about that, I think you should be supporting a property tax rate freeze. I would not agree with Stephen, though, about having another homelessness count, because that has been done. We have nonprofits who have just recently done that. The coalition has taken care of that. Clearly, what's needed are good, solid partnerships with senior levels of government, who not only provide some of the physical assets, but also the support services that are needed but it's also necessary for our partnerships with our nonprofit, who do a wonderful job and will continue to be there for us if we support them.
Have I missed anybody else on the panel this question? Thank you. Okay. So the next question. There are boarded up residential buildings, some of them close in our neighborhood, and they've been boarded up for over 10 years. One of them is now burned. These were truly affordable units. They were at the, you could rent those at the income assistance rates. What are you prepared to do about these boarded up buildings? And we'll start with Jason.
That's an interesting fact. I didn't know that there were a bunch of boarded up buildings that were actually, if they're structurally sound and they're actually usable as residential buildings, then I think we ought to be looking at our stock. Why don't we go through our whole city and see what buildings are there that might actually be viable houses that we could actually use right away. And I know they're probably owned by private people, and you'd have to try and find some way to bring them in and say, hey, look, maybe the community can get together and help fix a thing up and get it ready for you so that somebody could actually use it as affordable housing. But, you know, it's an interesting thing. I'm going to have to read more about that. Sorry about the not having a good answer.
Lisa helps. Lisa helps.
Thank you. I do hear a microphone buzz. I've been doing a lot of research, because that's my nature. I want to make sure I've got all the evidence before I make announcements or move forward. And one of the things that I've found is that this provincial government allows a number of tax exemptions. And one of them is an economic revitalization area tax exemption. And I thought, that can be used for business revitalization downtown, etc. But it can also be used for affordable housing. And I'm not proposing this tonight because I think it requires some careful study. But it is possible, according to provincial legislation, to designate a plot of land. So, for example, the derelict building on Yates Street, that could be designated as an economic revitalization area. A tax exemption could be granted in exchange for someone developing that as affordable housing. So there are tools, and it occurred to me we could use this not just for economic revitalization of business, but also for affordable housing. So that's something that I would like to look at should I be elected. I think there's some hope there.
I have a charm.
Thanks very much. And it really is a shame when you hear that something's been boarded up and no action has been taken for 10 years, and you have to then ask why. Why would people who own a piece of property not want to fix it up, renovate it, get it useful for the people and for a neighborhood? I guess the only answer you would probably be coming up with is that perhaps they're not getting the help or the assistance that they need from City Hall. Not a friendly place where you can learn about what you can do, what the process is. There's inconsistency that already takes place there. There's not clarity on what happens. There's interdepartmental overlaps. So if you own the property, would you want to spend all that time doing that? So one of the first things I believe you have to do is be much more customer friendly and focused, and allow people who want to contribute to their neighborhood feel that they can and be encouraged to do so. And maybe we'll get some of these boarded up buildings open again and for affordable housing.
Dean Thornton.
Boarded up buildings that don't provide housing drive me crazy. It just seems like such a shitload of waste. One of the things we discovered with the fire in View Towers, which I don't know if you remember, but there's 100 empty units sitting there, 350. Like there's 100 empty affordable housing units sitting there. We do not have the ability to force any private landowner to move people in. And that, you know, anywhere that I can say you must take someone in your basement, you got to put someone in your suite, you got to put someone in your garage. We can't do that. It means that you got to show leadership at the government level. We've done some stuff. Most recently for me as a counselor, we moved forward on, when I was a counselor, on the Spring Ridge, which was a real problem. We were able to move in, get the bylaws to actually bring in an opportunity to get new management in there, and those things are under control, providing good management. We've worked with nonprofits, and I think that's where we have to point, because once government starts getting involved and start giving grants and money away to for-profit people, it's an issue. But the energy, I mean, we help them through grants and work with CRD and the City of Victoria to put those 6 affordable housing units just above the coffee shop there. That's amazing work that you've done locally. And we bought the Travelers Inns. We've shown real leadership on this, and we want to keep doing that.
Changes believes that there really is no legitimate housing shortage in this community. Instead, there's a hidden housing surplus. It's a hidden surplus, unused buildings like these, the ones we're talking about, are part of that hidden surplus. We could go on about other aspects of what I'm calling a hidden surplus too, but that's part of it. These boarded-up buildings are privately owned, and this prevents their being used to meet community needs. So we're up against the paradox of private property. Something to think about.
Stephen Andrew. It drives Dean crazy. It drives me absolutely nuts, I have to tell you. I believe that what we should do, and I've looked into this, first thing is we need to provide a 5-year tax abatement, that a tax incentive, so that we can have rental housing built in this city. More rental stock will create more affordable housing. If you are going to have an empty parking lot or an empty building that's been burnt out, I think the first thing is we try the diplomatic approach. We go in, we try to convince you to move quickly on it, to bring it back online. If you're not, I think then what we can provide is disincentives. If you are going to sit on empty buildings, and if you are going to sit on empty parking lots just because of the tax issues, and once we've provided you with that incentive, I think then we can create a disincentive and just charge high property taxes on that until it becomes more feasible for them to actually get that building used again. We do not want to live in a city of empty buildings and parking lots. Right.
Okay, the next question. So this has to do with the St. Andrews site. That's at the corner of Vancouver and Pandora Avenue. Do you support the location of a 37,000 square foot grocery store or other big box store in that location? And we'll start with Lisa.
Thank you. It doesn't matter what I support. And this is really important. This is why I was talking earlier about, I will answer the question obviously. This is why I was talking earlier about a land use process where the city and the developer and the community all sit together. One of the things that is not known in the public is the city has no control over what kind of store a developer puts into a building.
You can downzone the site to prevent a large
Is the question, would I downzone the site? Of course I wouldn't downzone the site, because the official...
Ben Isaac has suggested that.
Well, excellent. I'm voting for Ben, too.
I am, yeah.
But the question is, would I support a grocery store in that site? Well, the city doesn't... This is important. The city doesn't have control about what goes into a building once it's built. The official community plan was developed by over 6,000 people. Now, I'm not saying that I support the development that's there. I think that we need to do some more work. But the city doesn't have control over what goes into developments once they're built, and it's important to understand that.
I had a job.
Thanks very much. And I think this goes back to a comment I made earlier about ensuring that neighborhood associations who want to be involved in the land use and want to have input with regard to what their area should look like. If it means certain development, if it means certain amenities that are maybe not parks, but are perhaps other grocery shops or maybe even a laundromat, things like that. As long as the community was made aware and was involved in that process at the beginning, so once the development was approved, then everyone would know, and then there wouldn't be this question about whether there should be something in there now or not, after the developer has started that process. To be fair, the neighborhood should have been advised or consulted to make sure that they knew what the amenities were going to be provided, and then the developer would have been able to accommodate that and not come into this conflict that I understand is now happening.
Dean.
To a certain extent, this is kind of where, and I appreciate Lisa's where she's coming from, but where our idea about putting staff into the community development process doesn't work. The official community plan is completely met. Staff can only sit there with the community and say, sorry, this developer, what he's bringing forward, meets the official community plan. It's important to recognize, and staff can't go against what their council sets. We set our policies, we do it. I mean, they just do what we do. We are ultimately their masters, because ultimately you are our masters. We need to make sure within the plans that there's opportunity for local community input. I'm happy that the developer has chosen to go back. Often at the development hearing, you roll the dice. You're going to win, you lose. I don't like picking winners and losers. I like making development that works for everybody. Is a 37,000 square foot grocery store, I think that's being proposed there. It brings challenges, and the major challenges is the amount of traffic that goes there. So we can't figure out how to manage the traffic, then it may not be an appropriate development, but we must keep an open mind, otherwise we're legally not allowed to hear, have you participate in the hearing as a mayor of the councilors.
Stephen Andrew. So that I'm not in a conflict, anything I say right now, I have an open mind. 37,000 square foot grocery store in that area, I have significant concerns about it because I've walked that area on a regular basis, I've done stories there. I used to live over at Johnson and Cook Street, so I used to go to Welpin all the time, and that's where I did my shopping. I think it would drastically change the area. Someone yelled from the audience that we could downsize it. The last time council used that technique, it was in the Songhees, and we ended up going to the Supreme Court of Canada and losing. It cost us millions of dollars. I don't think we need to go there. That's actually against the law, and so I want to be straight with you that that is not going to happen if I'm on council, because I don't want to be fighting a court battle. I would much rather work with the community and the developer and see that project come to fruition so it works for everybody, including the developer and the community. I think that's the most important job the council needs to take. Thank you.
Jason Ross.
Well, just by saying that's what's in the official community plan so that we can't go against that doesn't really answer the question, which to me is, why is it in the official community plan in the first place? When the official community plan was adopted, there was some dissent from the community about the heights of the buildings along that street. And I've got the video of that meeting, so I'm going to go back and review now and see what the community said, as well as what these people said, and actually cut it together and post it online sometime before the election, because I think it doesn't matter what we're saying now, it's what was said back then. What are the facts? And the fact that we don't have video for, you know, a large portion of this last term is indicative of just how little transparency actually occurs in the city right now.
Okay, well, I'm now going to move on to the 2-minute closings. And that will bring us close to 9 o'clock, and then we can sort of decide what we're going to do from there. But like you, the candidates, a chance to do their 2-minute closings. So we're going to start, and we drew lots on this one as well. And the first person to speak in their closing will be Dean Fortin, and he has 2 minutes. And there's still, just before you do that, Dean, there's still some, you can make some challenges, some 30-second challenges are still out there too.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to be sharing some of our thoughts here. I do agree with Jason, and I was on this panel at times, that it's difficult, and I don't think we really should have policy by sound bites. We got a minute, we got a minute and a half, and this is complex stuff. But fundamentally, you need to take a look and say, your mayor and your council, the people you're voting, who are they? look inside them and see what decisions they've made and where they come from. Because we make thousands of decisions every year that's not on our platform or not there, that we're put in situations of things that you want to bring forward, and then, frankly, you know, it's that old John Lennon thing that life is happens of when you're making plans. There's a whole lot of things that come forward that you have to deal with. So take a look who they are, what community involvement they have. That's really, really important. I've had really, I really enjoy being mayor. It's been an opportunity to meet, and whether I'm sitting in the hot tub at Crystal Pool, and everybody's talking to me about dogs off leashes or what to do, being available at this level of government is where we are. So keep talking to us, because where the good ideas come from. We're going to continue to work on the issues that are important to you, that we hear. We know affordable housing is important. We know livability is important. We know that we want to make sure that we have a city that we can have fun in. Michael Hyde, I mean, let's celebrate the fact that we've gone from 26 food trucks to 50. There's an explosion. People are coming back downtown. They're investing in a downtown. And our city is changing for the better. We have much more to do. As I say, it's an issue of continuous improvement. And we've got some exciting stuff that we can bring forward. You're going to hear more in the next week or two, and you're going to hear things in the next year and a half. There's amazing things that are coming forward. We live in a beautiful city. I want to thank you for sharing it with me. I want to thank you for you granting me the privilege to be mayor for the past two terms. And with your support, I'm looking forward to the opportunity to continue to make the changes for you.
Next will be Stephen Andrew.
Thank you very much. I appreciate this opportunity to talk to you as well, and I hope that you will check out the number on the front of my brochure, and I'm sure that we can have a longer conversation a little bit later, either after this event or on the telephone. I want to do what's best for Victoria. I'm not beholden to any political party, left, right, in between. I want to do what's best for the city. If it's a social issue that we are looking at, that doesn't mean the left has an exclusive right on that. If it's a good idea from wherever it comes, we should be grabbing it. That innovation, that change, and moving forward with it. We need to change our thinking. We need to start looking at solutions that are going to work for our city, that include people, that we go to the experts, and we seek your input. Taxes are out of control. The mayor says that they've had low tax increases for the past little while. Well, taxes are scheduled to go up 18% over the next 4 years. We're going to have a sewage issue that's going to come online that we don't know what the additional costs of the Johnson Street Bridge are. We have to deal with those. So the mayor, I think actually maybe it was Ida, dismissed my issue for the count of homelessness. This is not an idea I dreamt up. I went and spoke to social service providers. They say it's something they need so they can get a grip on it, and that then we would make the social service providers accountable for their goals. So they would set the goal of what they want to achieve, and then they would report back. We need to know what we are doing today is working. If accountability isn't there, how on earth do we continue to do it? I mean, you keep banging your head against the wall, hoping the next time you bang your head against the wall, you're not going to get a bruise. Well, we always know that you're going to get a bruise. So why do we stop doing that and try to do something else? And that's what I'm hoping is going to happen in the future. And the other issue that I want to talk about is homelessness. This is not just a Victoria problem. It's a regional issue. We need the feds, we need Island Health, and we need the province and our partners across the Greater Victoria area to assist us. If we try to go it alone, ladies and gentlemen, we will bankrupt ourselves. Thank you.
Jason Ross.
First I need to plug my website, moderndemocracy.ca, and my YouTube channel is also Modern Democracy. You can also find me on Twitter at Jason Ross, and I have a Facebook Modern Democracy page as well. This has been a really educational experience for me, this whole process, and we're getting close to the finish of it, and it's... obviously, I have issues with speaking publicly and being clear sometimes, and I apologize if I'm not doing that very well sometimes. It's hard. It's, like I said, I'm not a public speaker. I'm just a guy who's passionate about his city and passionate about governance in general. I'm liking to see a change. I want to see a different tone in the way your conversation takes. And, you know, I'm even uncomfortable with what I said to Dean earlier, and I do apologize, Dean. I get it. I just want to see good governance, and I want to see good conversation, and that's the most important thing. And if you don't want to vote for me, at least keep paying attention more. I mean, I wish this was the turnout at council every week. I wish that we had people engaged and paying attention to what we're doing, and I wish the information was out there in a way that it didn't require you so much time, so much effort to just get involved. I wish the barrier to entry was easier, and that's what I want to bring. Whether I get elected or not, that's what I'm focusing on. Using technology, using people power to really change the way the city works, and that will blossom out to other places as well. And that's my thing.
I had a job.
Thanks very much, and I want to thank you, the Fernwood Community Association, for hosting us. I began my comments tonight about some of the reasons why I want to be your mayor. Because I was born and raised here. What I'm seeing about the downtown four lease signs and all the empty storefronts is very dismaying for me. I also have hearing on the doorsteps about the property tax rates that have gone up 34% in the past 6 years. And tonight I've heard other candidates here talk about that too. Yet no one is prepared to offer that rate freeze as I am. And that is what distinguishes me from the others. I'm also concerned about what hasn't been discussed tonight. And that is the permissive tax exemptions for Victoria's churches, charities, and nonprofits. But that is going to be phased out after the election, as opposed to being talked about now. Is of great concern to me because our nonprofits, our churches and charities provide a great service to our community. And that was voted on in 2013, and it won't be implemented till after the election. Wonder why. I also want to take issue with a comment that was made about the Johnson Street Bridge project, because I have been digging into this so that you as taxpayers know what's going on, and it has not been brought out to the forefront. And I want to say that while Dean wants to deflect blame onto others and say that there wasn't any other dollars from other levels of government, particularly the provincial government, that does not change the fact that it is a cost overrun. Provincial governments do not fund municipal infrastructure projects that are only partially complete. And in fact, you shouldn't have done it either, Dean.
And the last speaker, although there is some people haven't used up their rebuttals yet, it changes the clown.
Lisa.
Oh, Lisa, sorry. Oh, you're actually next. Changes is closing. You're next. Sorry. Thank you for doing that.
Yeah, no problem. Thank you very much. I want to take one of my 2 minutes just to clarify some things that were said tonight. And one is about the city's Affordable Housing Trust Fund. At the Governance and Priorities Committee, where that came up, I did vote that we cut a little bit of money from that. Because I was trying to keep property taxes down so seniors could have affordable housing. But that was at Governance and Priorities. At the council meeting, where the final decisions made, I voted to keep money, all of it, into the Affordable Housing Trust Fund. You know why? Because I spent the 2 weeks between Governance and Priorities and council listening. I got new information. I learned that for every $10,000 that we put in, it leverages $1.4 million. So that's the kind of mayor I'll be. I will change my mind when I get new information. And that's really important. I would also like to know when I made a motion to close the crystal pool. So I'm going to ask Dean to provide that. He can do it on Facebook or Twitter. If I did that, I'd have to trade in my swimming card, so that wouldn't be very wise. And I happen to believe that the Crystal Pool is one of the fundamental recreational institutions in our city and in that part of town. So I'm fully in support of a publicly owned and operated swimming pool, and I commit to that on my website. So those are two pieces that I wanted to clear up. All right, so in real closing, I'm really excited about this election.
not just because I might have the opportunity to be your mayor for the next 4 years, but because of the excitement in the Vic High classes, at Camosun College, throughout the community. There's a real sense that democracy is, and probably part of it is thanks to Jason, democracy, local democracy is coming alive again. There are so many people engaged, not just in my campaign, in all these campaigns. And to me, that's really exciting. So you've heard a lot tonight. Now you've got a really hard job. Go home and pick one person to vote for on November the 15th. Thank you very, very much.
And now it changes the clown.
1 in 5 children, and absolutely amazing, 1 in 2 children of single mothers. That's 20% of children overall. More than half of children of single mothers live in poverty in Victoria. The provincial government continues to stubbornly ignore this social crisis in our community, and Changes really wants people to speak up about this, join Changes in calling for something to be done about this. 1 in 5 children and 1 in 2 children of single mothers living in poverty in Victoria. Changes the Clown believes that as the capital city of the province with the highest rate of child poverty in the country, year after year, the city of Victoria should demonstrate how this crisis can be addressed at the municipal level, despite the fact that it's actually under provincial jurisdiction. Two main planks of the Changes for Mayor election platform address this crisis of child poverty. The first of these is an affordable child care program at $10 a day, subsidized by the city. The City of Vancouver recently announced $30 million in funding for new affordable childcare spaces at the municipal level, providing a clear precedent for this. Change's second platform plank is a living wage policy, again with a precedent in this province. There's been a living wage policy in place in New Westminster for 4 years. I heard recently, just the other day actually, that there's a First Nations community, I think it's north of Tofino, somewhere on the island, that's instituted a living wage policy. Obviously a very different community than Victoria, but maybe this sort of thing's catching on. BC's minimum wage is only 54% of the living wage for Victoria. A full-time minimum wage worker makes less than $1,800 a month. When we consider that the cost of full-time childcare starts around $800 a month, it becomes clear why it's not possible for a lot of single mothers to work. And this obviously makes a big contribution to that rate of child poverty. Over half, which is just hard to believe, over half of children of single mothers in Victoria. So, talk to the politicians about how this is going to happen.
I'd like to thank all the candidates for participating tonight and also for running for office. It takes a lot of courage and a lot of time, and it's really appreciated.